Brad, you got me on? Yeah, there you go. Make me sound good. It's a tough, tough job. I mean, that's why you buy that equipment. Bless the Lord. Amen. Father, we do give you praise, honor, and glory. We thank you for life itself. We thank you for this great salvation. We thank you that we serve the living God. And Lord, I thank you that we can become your children, that we can be saved, that we can inherit eternal life, that we can know you in a personal way. And Father, I pray that you just continue to pour out your grace, open our eyes and our minds to hear and perceive your kingdom and to understand your will, that we might do those things that are pleasing in your sight. So Father, bless as only you can. Be glorified in the church, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Bless the Lord. Please be seated. Well, amen. I've been, over these past few weeks, except for 1 week, I've been talking about the covenants of the Lord. And I don't know about you, but I love the covenants of the Lord. Why? They're God's promises. And what I'd like you to get, I'm going to talk about King David today. I call it the Davidic covenant. God made a covenant with David. He makes covenants with certain people. And if you're that type of people, you can inherit those covenants. He made a covenant with Adam. And the covenant he made with Adam is, don't eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for in the day you eat it, you'll die. That was a promise God made. If he didn't eat that fruit from that tree, he wouldn't have died. Do you understand, even scientifically, it's not understood why we die? Because our body recreates itself and the cells recreate themselves. We were made to be eternal, but we die because of sin. Now, everybody's an Adam. We all understand that there are certain things you do, it's cost you, and there's a right and wrong. We realize that. And as long as we obey God, things go right. In fact, children are blessed if they obey their parents. Why? Because the authority of God in a child's life is the parent. By the way, it's not the school and it's not the government, it's the parent. And you have to take that responsibility. But children who love their mom and dad and go along with the program, they're blessed in what they do. They're happy. They've got a joyful spirit. And sometime down the road, usually in teenage years or maybe even before, some after that, but we get disobedient to our parents and sinners enters our life. Then all of a sudden, everything isn't happy-go-lucky. Things go wrong. Things go upside down. You begin to have problems. There's stress comes in your life because you have violated a covenant God made with Adam. And we're all of Adam. He's the father of the human race, And so in Adam, all sin, in Adam, all die. So death has entered the world and we all die. Everybody's going to die because you're in Adam. And because we all sinned in the matter of Adam, we all violated something in our life that violated God. Some people might have murdered somebody. Some people might have stolen something. You might have just lied. You might have disobeyed your parents. Whatever you did, you violated God and death is in our life. So we're all going to die. And we're all, our body's going to be in the grave or wherever you might, in a tomb or whatever. But only in Christ Jesus is there promise of the resurrection. And the proof of the resurrection is that he rose from the dead. Why? Death couldn't hold him. Why? He didn't sin like Adam. He totally obeyed his heavenly Father unto death. And he lived. And we're heading for that relationship. We're in our Christian walk, I pray you look at this as an adventure in life. You're walking out this thing, and most of us go from covenant to covenant. Now, let me see if I can explain that. Of course, when you get to Christ, the covenant of Christ, the grave couldn't hold him because death couldn't hold him because he never sinned. So he rose from the dead, and for us, the encouragement that he rose from the dead, so we have that promised to us that if we're in Christ, if we abide in Christ, we're going to raise from the dead at the last trumpet. So anyhow, what I want you to look at, so we're all like in the covenant of Adam. As long as you don't eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, as long as you don't violate what you know is wrong, you do okay. You have a good spirit. Things go well for you. But when you violate that, then there becomes a problem. And we know this, that there's a consequence to sin. In the world, sin got so bad that at the time of Noah, God was so... He regretted that he made man because mankind got bad. By the way, when you read the Bible, when you read God destroyed a nation, you go, gee, how could he do that? They were just wonderful people doing wonderful things and God killed them. They were evil people. They were sacrificing their babies. They were perverted in every manner of perverted. They sinned, they murdered, they lied, they cheated, they stole. They were evil. And guess what? Evil people, I don't care if you go to church. If you're an evil person, you're going to go to, excuse me, you're going to go to hell. God, death can't abide with life. Just like darkness can't abide with light. You turn on him, lights, the darkness flees. It's going to happen every time. Well, same with God. You can't enter the presence of God and be full of sin, full of self, and violating everything God stands for and everything God is, and think that it's going to be okay. It's not going to be okay. Sinners don't go to heaven. Saints go to heaven. And God gave you opportunity to become saints, and he does it by means of his covenant. He makes a promise. If you are do this and that, I'll do. He does his part. He's a covenant-keeping God. What's that mean? He keeps his word. So, you know, Noah realized that God punished sin. And Noah also realized that God said, I'll never do that again. He trusted God's word. And God put a rainbow in the sky to remind us that God keeps his word. He's a covenant-keeping God. And Noah and his sons and his children were righteous people. And God took note of that. So you can be assured of this. If you live righteously, God will take note of you. But we have a righteousness as a Christian that's imparted to us. It's not one you inherited naturally. It's imparted to you. What I'm talking about? You received the Holy Spirit. But we're going to get to that. But anyhow, so now we have Adam, and there was a covenant made with Adam. He violated it, ate from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. There was a covenant made with Noah that God will never flood the earth again and destroy all mankind. By the way, the earth is going to be destroyed again with fire, not with water. And that's coming. That's a promise. But then down the road, we find Abraham. God made a covenant with Abraham. In fact, we talked about the Abrahamic covenant. What was it about Abraham that God would make a covenant with him? It's the same thing. It couldn't be in you that he'll make that same covenant with you. Abraham trusted God. He's a father of faith. It was very evident he trusted God and did whatever he believed God would have him to do, even to the point he was going to sacrifice his son, believing still that God was good and could raise him from the dead. So he trusted God, and I'm challenging you as a Christian, you want to be part of that covenant. And by the way, when you get to the covenant of Christ, all the covenants belong to you. But a lot of us are somewhere in that. We might not even be in the new covenant yet, but we're on this journey. So if you begin to walk by faith and you begin to trust God and draw this conclusion, God is good and he does good and he works all things for good. So you trust him how? Unconditionally. You put your faith and trust in God and believe that whatever he lets me go through is for my benefit and my good. And out of that should come grace. And the promise to Abraham was that he'll make you the father of many nations. Well, what? His descendants. By the way, all of us who are of faith are descendants of Abraham. Because it's a spirit. It's not a natural bloodline. It's a spirit. So you want to be of faith. And you want to be a child of Abraham. And by the way, most people who live in faith and exercise their faith. By the way, if you're a phony, you're never going to fool your children. You need to be of faith, and you need to speak faith, and you need to live faith, and it needs to be evident to your children that you're of faith, and then when you talk to them, they believe you. And if you're of faith, you have the promise of your children and their children and their children. We sing a song, their children and their children and their children. Well, you find people of faith, the people I know of faith, their children turn out good. And if the children keep the faith, their children turn out good. And if they're you become the father of many nations. And it goes on and on and on. People of faith have multiplied over the years. But somewhere in there, we don't let people get out of faith. And how you keep people in the faith is you go to the next covenant. It's the covenant of Moses. Here's the law of God. The law came that we could identify sin. We know about righteousness. Trust God. That's righteous. Stand on his promises. That's righteous. But to know what God approves of and disapproves of. You know, in the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, they just ate the fruit. But here, Moses goes on a mountain and gets us the law of God. If we live by the Ten Commandments, the Ten Commandments are a covenant. If you keep the Ten Commandments in your life, you're going to be promised. You're going to be promised God will bring you to a promised land. Well, what's a promised land? Well, we live in America. It's kind of a promised land in the natural. I know you might not like the direction it's going in right this minute. I don't either, but come on, it's been a promised land. It's been a land flowing with milk and honey. I mean, you could come here and make money and keep money and live a moral life, and our founding fathers knew about the commandments. And they knew that this great idea that they had, this government that they developed, would work if the people self-governed by the Ten Commandments. So if you teach your children the Ten Commandments, and if they keep those commandments, there's promises that'll come to them. You know, and the promise for us, the promised land could be a nice house, a job where you make a decent income, a good mate. I mean, there's promises that'll come to pass if you just keep the commandments, you do that. So that there's that covenant. And what was it? Moses was faithful to God in everything. Moses sought God. You know, the first time Moses met the Lord, it was a burning bush. And the bush was burning and it wasn't burned up. And the Lord said, take off your shoes, you're on holy ground. And Moses began to follow that God and go where that God would have him to go and do what God would have him to do. And he actually set people free. Well, you know, if you keep the law of God, if in your personal life you will not violate those commandments and you get the spirit of that, where you're not violating the commandments of God, you're going to influence people. When you say something, people are going to listen. When you testify, people will hear you. Because you're in a covenant relationship with God, and he'll bless you. If you keep the covenant, you read the blessings. And if you violate that covenant, read the curses. I told you when you go home, read, I think it was Deuteronomy or Exodus 27. I gave you those. Because in there is the blessing of the law, how everything will go good. You'll be prospered when you go in, when you come out. Your enemies will come in against you one way and flee 10 ways, and you'll overcome your enemies. It's just, you have this overcoming power that's in your life if you just keep the commandments. And that's an awesome thing. But if you violate the commandments and you know the commandments and you don't care and you violate them, there's a curse that comes on your life. Now, I would hope that when the things you go through as a Christian are because of the testing of your faith, not because of the punishment, and you're fallen under the curse. But, you know, the end of the curse is death. And only Jesus Christ can save you from that, where you don't have any fear of death. So Moses was faithful in his whole house. Everything God gave him to do, he did. In fact, this is contrary to most people's theology, but I want you to think about this. God got so upset with Israel. You know why? They grumbled and complained. They lived in bondage. They had to get bricks and roast bricks up. And then when there was a complaint, they made it worse on them. They had to, this is what they did. They were miserable. And here comes somebody to set them free, and they have this journey to go on, and they're complaining about the journey and saying it was better back then. You know what? We have a short memory. You can be miserable, and then if you're doing something later on, you get miserable again. You think the other misery was better than this misery. They were going to a promised land. I mean, they saw God. Come on, they saw miracles. They saw the Red Sea parted. You know, the army of the Egyptians was going to come and kill them. They didn't have nothing. They're a bunch of slaves. And God delivered them. They didn't know where to go. Well, there's a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of light by night. They followed that. Moses gave them the direction. And they were walking by faith. They were following Moses, who was the lawgiver. By the way, there are lawgivers. There are people who have authority to give law. You know, you got a sign out there that says 55 miles an hour. If there's nobody to enforce it, it's just an idea. But when somebody's going to, now when it becomes enforceable, all of a sudden it becomes sin. You know, it's like a child running around who don't know right from wrong. When he realizes right, it becomes sin. You know, if your parents never correct you about something, it's not sin to you. In fact, without somebody to enforce the 55 mile an hour speed limit, it's liberty. With nobody to enforce it, like, well, I'm free, man. I drive fast at once. That's a good idea, 55, but man, I'll go 80. But as soon as it becomes enforceable, it becomes sin to you. Well, when you realize that this stuff is from God, the Ten Commandments are from God, he has authority to bless you and he has authority to discipline you and to punish you for keeping that. Now it becomes sin. It's going to cost you if you do wrong. He wants to bless you. The whole thing is to keep you in the blessing. But if you refuse the blessing of God and you refuse to walk in, if you refuse to exercise the Abrahamic covenant, in other words, if you refuse to walk in faith and you violate the commandments, there's a consequence to that. It's going to happen. Drug addicts and alcoholics and rebellious people die young. Perverted people die young. Why does that happen? Because there's cursed. There's a curse in violating God. Now, can God give space to somebody who's ignorant? He does. But your ignorance won't get you to heaven. That's why Jesus said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. It's the duty of every man, woman, and child to seek God and come to know God. That's in you, and you know that. That's why we have church. It's why we have teaching. It's why we have the Bible. We have the word of God in order to learn that. So, anyhow, wonder mother, then God made a covenant with David. Now, we're headed towards a new covenant. Maybe next week we get there. But this covenant with David, here's what I want, again, think of. Adam was aware of God. Most human beings are aware of God. Sister Donna told me the other day, she was talking to somebody, and the guy said, he's an agnostic. He goes, well, then you believe in God. He said, no, I don't. He said, how can you be an agnostic if there's no God? You know, I don't believe in God. Well, how can you believe in what doesn't exist? So why would it? That's insanity. But anyhow, let's go on with this. But Moses was faithful. Moses was faithful to the calling. Moses was faithful to God. Moses kept the commandments. He tried to get the people to keep the commandments. In fact, what I started to tell you is God got so mad at the Israelites for grumbling and complaining and all that God was going to kill them all, start all over again with Moses. And Moses said, Lord, the world, the Egyptians, will think you couldn't deliver them. Now, I want you to think about this. How much influence did Moses have with God? God changed his mind. Now, there are people who will teach you that God never changed his mind. He knows the beginning from the end, every thought, every word, everything is orchestrated, and you're a bunch of robots. No, God changed his mind and didn't destroy him. He said, okay, but we're going to leave them in the desert for 40 years until they just die on their own. God didn't kill them, but he let them die. And then he said, and all the things they were worried about, we're going to let their children enter the promised land. And they entered the promised land. But the amazing, amazing things. But understand the characteristics of these believers. The characteristics of Adam knew there was God. Noah knew that God punished evil. Abraham learned to trust God. If you trust God, good things happen to you. Moses knew about the law of God, right and wrong. God gave it to him. Went on the mountain and written out by the hand of God. And then there was King David. King David was a unique guy. And what I want you to see is, what is it about David that God made a promise to him? I'm going to read you the scriptures on these in a minute. But King David, I would say first and foremost, David was a praiser. And if you're somebody who praises God and worships God and does like David did and you rejoice in the Lord and you trust in the God of your salvation, you're going to go past Moses. I mean, you're going to go past, Moses, I'm sorry. And you're going to keep going on. David didn't lose battles. The only time David had a hard time in his life is when he sinned. Oh, he did. I mean, he committed adultery. He had the lady's husband killed. He blew it big time. David knew this. He knew this. And when you study David, he knew he deserved to die. Knew he was stone wrong. And what David said, and I love this, he said, against thee and thee alone I've sinned, O God. He saw and knew that his sin was against God because he violated the laws of God to do what he did. And because he had this repentant heart and because he knew he deserved to die, God had mercy on him and forgave him. He still got disciplined. Big time. And you know what? He got disciplined and didn't complain. And when his enemies came against him and badmouthed him, and his Shimei threw stones at him and called him, cursed him, and told him he was a murderer and all that. And the men that were with David wanted to kill Shimei, and David said, maybe the Lord sent him. You know, this is part of what I have to go through because of what I've done. So, you know, if people think today that you sin and because of Jesus, well, it's just forgiven, there's no consequence. There's always a consequence to your sin. There isn't. You violate God, there's a consequence to it. But be like David. Be quick to own up to it. Be quick to take your comeuppance and be sure that you know you've sinned against God. Yes, it always affects people, but you sinned against God. So David was a unique thing. In fact, in Israel, they were expecting a son of David to come and be on the throne and rule Israel. When Jesus came and they thought he was a son of David, I'll read you those scriptures and show you that. But Israel was looking for the reestablishment of the greatness of Israel. They wanted to see a descendant of David on the throne to make Israel great again, just like in the days of Solomon, David's son. In the days of Solomon, everybody was wealthy. Everybody prospered. King Solomon had shields in his house that were made of pure gold. I mean, silver was common. Everybody prospered. Everybody had servants. It was incredible. In Israel, being under Roman domination, wanted to be free from that denomination and were looking for a savior who was of the son of David to come and reestablish the kingdom of Israel. That's why you'll see the questions that they asked. That's what they were looking for. And it was prophesied scripturally. So they had that in mind, not understanding that the Lord was coming to establish his kingdom, who Jesus is, by the way, a son of David, and that his kingdom would be an everlasting kingdom, and that his kingdom would be a spiritual kingdom. And Jesus even said to his disciples, I grant you a kingdom. By the way, you've been granted that kingdom if you're in Christ, and the kingdom's in your heart. One day it'll be of the world. There's going to be a new heaven and a new earth where righteousness dwells. The kingdoms of this world are going to become the kingdoms of our Christ, and it's going to be a great place to live, and you'll never die. That's what we're looking for. It's not just being on a cloud in heaven. There's going to be a new heaven and a new earth, and it's going to be filled with righteous people who love God and love each other. There won't even be a law because there'll be no need of a law. There won't even be need of authority because everybody will do right. That's what we're looking for. Everybody will be a right human being. So anyhow, let me read these scriptures that I labored to print out. Because I used these same scriptures in 2019, but it's now 2021, so we're going to use them again. Because I know all you guys with photographic memories are going to remember every scripture, so. Anyhow, Matthew 1, you know, is the book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. To Abraham was born Isaac, and to Isaac was born Jacob, and to Jacob was born Judah and his brothers. By the way, you know, the genealogy is in the Bible for a reason. And if you try to study it and figure it out, just about will drive you crazy. But it can be. You can trace the bloodline, and you'll see that Joseph was of the bloodline, Mary's of the, it all comes together. They are those people who are prophesied about. And we're not going to read a whole genealogy. I can't even pronounce the names. I read the genealogy, especially when you get an Old Testament and you do the, and so-and-so begot. I just go, begot Ralph, begot Harry begot Joe. See, come on. These names, I can't do it. I feel like that's why I think we're talking tons. It got to be Hebrew or something. But anyhow, in Matthew 1:6 it says, and to Jesse was born David the king, and to David was born Solomon, and by her who had been the wife of Uriah. And to Jacob was born Joseph, now we're down in the New Testament, and the husband of Mary, to whom was born Jesus, who is called Christ. Now God's covenant with David, here in 1 Samuel 7, 12 through 16, it says this. He's talking to David. When your days are complete and you lie down with your fathers, I will raise up your descendant after you who will come forth from you, and I will establish his kingdom. So it's got to be of the bloodline of David, or he's not the Christ. Every prophecy concerning the Christ is fulfilled. So that to the fact that there can be no question, Jesus is the Christ. Jesus is our Savior. He is God revealed in the flesh. That is if you study this stuff, you couldn't do this. You couldn't even orchestrate this. You couldn't have a group of men plan this and make it work. You couldn't make it work because it covered thousands of years. So anyhow, and it goes on and says, and he will build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. Well, we know Solomon built the temple, and it was a son of David. But he's talking about one, a kingdom that will be established forever. It's an everlasting kingdom that Jesus brings. The church is going to be everlasting. And he says, and I will be a father to him, and he will be a son to me. And when he commits iniquity, I will correct him with the rods of men and with the strokes of the son of men. By the way, who punished Jesus? Men did. He violated their rules, their laws, and they punished him. They beat him and hung him on a cross and did all those things. But listen to what God says. But my love and kindness shall not depart from him, as I took it away from Saul, whom I removed before you. So the promise of the descendant of David, who is going to have the kingdom, he's going to be punished, but his God's loving kindness will never depart from him. And that's really speaking of Jesus. And it goes, and your house and your kingdom shall endure before me forever, and the throne shall be established forever. Jesus Christ is king, David's descendant forever, and he rules and reigns in heaven forever, and he has an everlasting kingdom that we've become a part of, and that everlasting kingdom will never pass away. That's what we're looking for. Now, the covenant God made, God says, my covenant I will not violate, listen to this now, nor will I alter the utterance of my lips. And I love this. Once I have sworn in my holiness, that's God, because he swears by himself, because there's nobody greater to swear by. He says, once I have sworn in my holiness, I will not lie to David. Are you a David? God will tell you the truth and reveal the truth, and he'll never lie to you. That's the Davidic covenant. He said, I will not lie to David. What's David like? What is it about David that God loves? One, he got a repentant heart. We know that. It's this kind of stuff. I will give thanks to the Lord with all my heart. I will tell of his wonders. Do you testify? Are you a praiser? Are you a King David? It's that characteristic that gets blessed, and God will reveal himself to you, and he'll not lie to you. He'll let you know what's going down. He'll be with you 24/7. Do you have the spirit of David? Can you read the Psalms and you don't know David? Can you read the Psalms and your spirit not soar? He was a praiser. He was a worshiper of God. Listen to this. Psalm of David. I will give thanks with all my heart. I will sing praises to thee before the gods. What do you mean before the gods? You know, if you see each other out someplace and it's just you and a brother or sister in Christ, and you see each other, go, praise the Lord. You go and give a hug and a kiss, whatever. Say, praise the Lord. It's wonderful, isn't it, when you see a brother or sister? But how about if you're in the middle of some of your friends who are worldly, or somebody has some authority, and you see one of your brothers or sisters walking in front of this crowd who don't say praise the Lord, and you go, praise the Lord. Are you a David? He praised the Lord before gods. I really promote answering your phone, praise the Lord. But some of you won't do that because somebody might call who's going to judge you, and they're going to think you're a religious fanatic. The devil is lying to you. Do you care if they think you're a religious fanatic, or do you care about praising God? What's your priority? What's your priority? You say, Pastor, you can't show me where I'm supposed to answer my phone prayer. I know. Okay, then don't answer it. That's on you. But I'm telling you, I will praise the Lord. And I'll praise the Lord to anybody. I don't care if I see an atheist. I see an atheist, hey, praise the Lord. I don't believe in God. Well, praise the Lord anyhow. I do. And he don't lie to me, but somebody's lying to you, and that's your God, and that's called the devil, and he's the father of all lies. By the way, there's a lot of lies going on in America right now. A lot of lies. In fact, you watch the news, it kind of gets grievous because they lie with conviction. Jeez. Never mind. Don't go there. This is better. This is much, much better. I will give thee praises with all my heart. I will sing praises to thee before the gods. Why David? He raised up David to be their king, concerning whom he also testified and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse. Now, this is Peter on the day of Pentecost talking right now. And what's he say? What's this about David? He's a man after my heart. That's what God says, who will do all my will. David did the will of God. He pursued the will of God and desired to do the will of God. That's why God made promises to him. That's why Christ came from that line of David. David did the will of God best he could and failed a few times. Now, he didn't fall in his faith. He was in a part of the Abraham covenant. Why, when he went and fought Goliath, there was no fear. You know, he sang about fear. He faced, I think Goliath was like 9'6". And he came with a slingshot. And David was offended. He said, "Who are you to impugn the armies of the living God?" He was offended for God. It wasn't about David. "Oh, I can whip this guy." It wasn't that at all. He was offended for God. And when people talk falsely about your God, it ought to offend you too, especially if they criticize Jesus. Say, "Hold it, buddy." Anyhow, when Jesus finally came, again, the expected kingdom, they were expecting the reestablishment of like Solomon's day and David's day. That's what they were looking for, to get out from under the Roman rule and to reestablish the kingdom. And watch this. "And as Jesus passed on from there, two blind men followed him, crying out, saying, 'Have mercy on us, son of David.'" Why, they were looking for a son of David to be the savior of Israel. "And the multitude going before him and those who followed after him were crying out, saying, 'Hosanna to the son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.'" The Jews were getting excited because they thought a natural savior was coming. They thought Jesus would reestablish Israel. "And blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest. And all the multitudes were amazed and begin to say, 'This man cannot be the son of David, can he? Is this who we've been waiting for? Is this who we've been waiting to fix us?" Come on, if we go down much further than we are and we're going to look for somebody to come and fix it. Well, they were looking for somebody to come and fix it, and they knew the scriptures and they knew it was going to be a son of David. "And so when they had come together, they were asking him," okay, the disciples are asking Jesus, saying, "Lord, is it at this time you are restoring the kingdom of Israel?" That's what they were all thinking. Even when they followed Jesus, they're thinking, he's the son of David. He's going to be the fixer. He's going to be the new king of Israel. He's going to sit on the throne and get rid of the Romans. And that's what they were looking for. And they even asked Jesus that. "Is it time for the restoring of the kingdom of Israel? Lord, are you going to put us back to our greatness?" And here was the answer they got. "And he said to them, 'It is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own power.'" But then he gave the important thing that's going to happen. "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and even the remotest parts of the earth." And Peter goes on and he's preaching. He says, "This man," speaking of Jesus, "delivered up by the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God, you nailed him to a cross by the hands of godless men and put him to death." This were on the day of Pentecost. Peter's preaching. God always planned to send a savior for mankind. From the beginning, why? He gave us free will. And if you have free will, you can choose to do wrong. And because we're human beings and we have natural inclinations, we're going to do wrong. God had provision made from eternity, from everlasting to everlasting. Christ was going to come. And he came. Anyhow, let me read that to you again. "This man," speaking of Jesus, "delivered up by the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God, you nailed him to a cross by the hands of godless men and put him to death." And he goes on and says, "And God raised him up again, putting an end to the agony of death, since it was impossible for him to be held by its power." Jesus couldn't stay dead because there was no death in him. He didn't corrupt. I like to think, after 3 days in the tomb, if you would have sent a coroner in and said, "How long has he been dead?" He would have checked him and goes, "If he's dead, he just now died," because there would be no evidence of him dying. There would be no stink. There would be no decay because there was no death in him. "For David says of him, 'I was always beholding the Lord in my presence, for he is at my right hand that I may not be shaken. Therefore, my heart was glad and my tongue exulted. Moreover, my flesh will also abide in hope, because thou hast not abandoned my soul to Hades, nor allowed thy Holy One to undergo decay." David rejoiced. Christ rejoiced. By the way, there's scripture where Jesus rejoices with great joy, especially when he sent the sent the apostles out and they came back giving testimony of people being converted. He rejoiced in the Spirit. It says, thou hast made known to me the ways of life. Thou wilt make me full of gladness with thy presence. You know, I think maybe some of you, we forget that. Get filled with the Holy Spirit. The new covenant is the new covenant, which we're going to talk about, except we really talk about it every week. When you're born again of the Spirit and your sins are forgiven because of Jesus Christ and you've been in the waters of baptism, you're becoming a partaker of the new covenant. He is going to change your heart. He's going to change your life. He's going to change your nature. You're going to become a new creature in Christ. And without that, you don't have hope. Our hope is in Jesus Christ that he will do this work and you'll become a child of God. What's a child of God like? Like Jesus. Jesus honored his Father. Never violated the commandments. Loved people, ministered to people, shared. Had a great ministry that was anointed. So listen to what Peter goes on and says here. I want to read the one before that. Thou shalt make known to me the ways of life. Have you figured that out yet? Thou wilt make me full of gladness with thy presence. When the Spirit of God is in your heart, all of a sudden, no matter what you're going through, everything's okay. Dad showed up. My Father's here. It's going to be all right. How do I know it's going to be all right? Because God can do anything. He's a good God. You're to delight in that. You're to be aware of that. You're to be aware that God's for you. You know, unless you're a sinner and a willful sinner, God's for you. If you want to walk in faith, you walk in righteousness. Trust him. He'll lead you, he'll guide you, and he'll bless you beyond what you can even think or imagine. But Peter goes on in Pentecost and says, brethren, I may confidently say to you regarding the patriarch David that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is here with us today. And so because he was a prophet and he knew that God had sworn to him with an oath to seat someone, one of his descendants upon his throne, he looked ahead and spoke of the resurrection of Christ, that he was neither abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh suffer decay. This Jesus God raised up again, to which we are all witnesses. So to the Israelites, he's in Israel, and he's speaking these things, and all the people who had the knowledge of the scriptures and what they said and of David, they're seeing it fulfilled before their eyes. This Jesus God raised up again, to which we're all witnesses. Therefore, having been exalted to the right hand of God, by the way, the right hand of God, he's put in the place of power and authority. And having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured forth this which you both see and hear. What happened? The Holy Spirit was poured out. Come on, the day of Pentecost, like a mighty rushing wind and flames of fire on everybody's head, and they all begin to speak in other tongues that the Holy Spirit was giving them utterance. And there's people from all over the world at Israel at that time, and on the day of Pentecost, that they're all speaking in tongues, and every person's hearing them speak in their own language. If you were an Italian, they were saying Italian. If you're Polish, you were hearing in Polish. If you were Jew, you were hearing Hebrew. That's the miracle of Pentecost that was going on. How God is, that was the founding of the church of Jesus Christ. And by the way, your whole journey in life is to go from covenant to covenant to covenant. But boy, if you don't end up at the last covenant, the covenant with Christ, you're missing it. Listen to this. For it was not David who ascended into heaven, but he himself says, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make the enemies a footstool for your feet. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus who you crucified. And what's Apostle Paul teach us? Us Gentiles, remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, descendant of David, according to my gospel. Why ascended of David? Because the prophecies are fulfilled. Over all those years, the prophecies were fulfilled perfectly. In fact, when you study the prophecies concerning Christ in the Bible, it is overwhelming the evidence that he is the Christ. If people think this is a fairy tale and stuff, you've not done your homework. We have some incredible history that you can study and find out this stuff is true. This isn't a fairy tale. This isn't some dumb religion that man made. This religion's been established by God. He's the one who established the covenants. And if you're of faith, you have the covenant with Abraham. If you keep the law, you have a covenant of Moses. If you're a praiser, you have the covenant of David. But if you come to Christ in salvation, you have the covenant of life. Bless the Lord. Revelation 22:16 says, I, Jesus, have sent my angel to testify to you these things for the churches. And listen what he says about himself. I am the root and offspring of David, the bright and morning star. That's the Lord we serve. He's a covenant-keeping God. He keeps his word. You can trust his word. You can live his word. You can depend on his word. And I'm telling you, get the Davidic covenant working for you. Be a praiser. Don't be backwards about praising God. Don't be backwards about saying, bless the Lord. Raise up holy hands. Sing the songs. Play them on your, in your car. Be a praiser. I'm telling you, there's great benefit in that. You want God to take care of you? Be a praiser. You want to stay healthy? Keep the commandments. You want good health? You want healing? You know, there is no promise we won't get sick, but there's promises about healing. Keep the covenants. Walk in them. Understand what's available to you because of what God's done and that he keeps his word and he's a covenant-keeping God. Well, bless the Lord. I don't know about you, but I love this information. I love to know, what I, and when I think about, what was about Adam? Well, everybody had that. Well, what about Noah? Everybody understands a promise. Everybody sees a rainbow. You know, what about Abraham? He trusted God. Trust God. You know, what we do, what we want to do in a church, we want to control God. Doesn't work that way. He's God. You're the servant. You trust him, and he will bless you. And as he blesses you, you keep those commandments, and all those promises are yours. You'll prosper and do well. If you're a praiser, even Goliath can't stand. Come on. David took a lamb out of a lion's mouth. You say, oh, did that really happen? Yes, it really happened. Amen. Bless you, Lord. Father, I pray that we might come to know and understand that you're a covenant-keeping God. And Lord, that we're partakers of those covenants, that we learn to trust you, to put our faith and our hope entirely in you and in your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, that we know there's a resurrection from the dead. And Lord, we know that our sins are forgiven because of the price your Son paid on the cross. Lord, we thank you for that forgiveness of sins. And we thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit, that we might indeed be powered to behave in a manner that's pleasing to you and to be called children of the Most High God. So Lord, bless your church. Let us all grow up in all aspects unto him who is the head, even Christ our Lord. Be glorified in the church, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. God bless you. I love you. Be filled with the Holy Spirit.